studios here in Colombo. We're starting a new week and some explosive revelations today, of course, concerning the Express Pearl ship that is currently the stricken ship off the coast of the Colombo port, a few nautical miles off the Colombo port. Now, this ship caused a real stir here in Sri Lanka, and throughout the past few days we've been receiving some very sad news as far as turtles washing up ashore, a number of dolphins also washing up ashore. Even today a number of marine creatures had washed up ashore. However, there is no clear confirmation that these deaths were caused by the fire that happened on board the ship. However, environmentalists and various other experts do have an opinion that the chemicals from this ship, or this incident that happened, would have affected such large numbers, of course, of turtles and dolphins, which are some tough creatures in the sea, to pass away like this and for their carcasses to wash ashore on Sri Lankan soil. Well, as far as we are saddened by the damage that has been caused by this incident, and as far as Sri Lankans are affected, there is a multi-pronged approach, of course, to this incident on how we respond to this. The authorities are currently assessing the damages and working on the claims against the insurer, of course, of this ship to claim the damages that have been caused to Sri Lankan water so that we can hopefully try to restore some of this environment back. Now, to discuss these matters and more, we've got on our show this evening attorney at law Sarath Gunawardhana. He is a senior lecturer at the Institute of Shipping and Logistics, and also the former general manager of the Ceylon Shipping Corporation, a person who has much expertise in handling claims when it comes to casualties at sea. A very good evening, sir, and welcome to the show.
Good evening, Shamal.
Mr. Gunawardhana, we've been discussing this issue for quite a long time. We discussed on who is liable, how we're going to get this claim, the environmental damage that this has caused. My first question to you really is, this new development that happened today, that of course I need to remind our viewers of the facts that were presented in court by the Attorney General's department, stated that the investigations conducted thus far have revealed that the local agent of this ship that is that caught on fire, that's involved in this incident, had deleted the email that was sent by the ship informing the local agent of this leak, and also that the local agent had informed the authorities when this ship requested permission to come in that the ship was in secure condition. Do these developments, how do these developments affect Sri Lanka's ability or the process of claiming compensation as far as this incident goes?
As far as the compensation claim is concerned, that deleting the email by a local agent as a result of that vessel coming closer to the port is not very important, because now it has happened. So for this matter, I think there should be some domestic inquiry about the local agent and whether it has happened that way. Because if the local agent or the vessel's master had informed the port authority that there is a leakage, I am sure that port authority should have asked the master to anchor the vessel far away, not closer to the port. But as far as the compensation claim is concerned, that is not very important. Now it has happened and ship owner is liable to pay compensation for the Sri Lankan government, and Sri Lankan government should claim from the ship owner for two matters. One is for the environmental damage, and secondly for the wreck removal.
So for the removal, for the operations that were conducted to douse the fire, to handle the situation there, for that, the damage.
That's right.
So there were some controversial statements, of course, I must confess, made regarding this incident. There were some senior politicians who came out and said, you know, maybe this is a good thing that this happened. Now we can claim a good compensation to really compensate for this amount, and this will help in our economy in some way. Can we really compensate fully for the damage that this incident has caused in Sri Lanka, judging by experience?
I don't think that the compensation that we receive anyway will be sufficient for long-term effects for the environment pollution, because we don't know as yet 100% what is the damage, and as far as the legislation with regard to this type of casualties, they call cleaning up expenditure, and so other damages are consequential damages. Now it is a matter for us to claim direct losses. That is kind of cleaning up expenditure, and also the losses that will be come forth not only nowadays but even
in the future as well.
In future, those are something like indirect losses or consequential losses, and the vessel has two insurance covers. One is for the vessel's hull and machinery, and secondly for the vessel's third party liabilities. Now these two claims, that is the wreck removal and environmental damage, both are, as far as the insurance is concerned, third party liabilities for the ship owner. And so now damage has to be assessed, and claim has to be prepared and submitted to the ship owner, and in turn ship owner will get the ship owner's PNI club, that is the protection and indemnity club, who has issued the liability insurance policy,
right,
for them to settle the claim. So I am not aware how much the claim will be, because I don't have any knowledge about the damage that has happened to environment.
Well, I don't think anyone really, even the authorities, have really gathered so much data to come up with that information or to come up with that number, and they are in the process of doing it.
Yeah, but there is a procedure to follow. Now I have worked for Ceylon Shipping Corporation from 1977 to 2009, and from 1998 to 2009 I was the general manager. We have faced similar situation, but not in such
this
a
magnitude.
Large scale, such a large scale, but similar incident in small scale, and but our claims, I mean, in one incident, I remember our claim was nearly $1 million. The damages caused to the vessel. What we do immediately when the damage occurred, that is an explosion of a gas tanker on ship in the same area in Gulf. Our underwriters, on behalf of us, underwriters in the sense, our ship was owned by us, and ship has two insurance covers. One is for the hull of the ship, other one is for the
third party liabilities.
Yeah, because now we forecasted third party liabilities, because cargo also got damaged. Cargo owners are supposed to be third parties.
Right.
And we immediately retain, our insurance club, because whatever we pay, insurance company has to pay us. Whatever we incur by way of settlement of claims, our insurance company has to reimburse us. Therefore, they come forward to advise us what to do. Retain a firm of solicitors in London who are experts in maritime casualty claims, and firm handling claim adjustments. They are called average adjusters. And then first thing, the solicitors firm, in consultation with us in London, in Colombo, did was send a letter of demand to the operator of the ship, because this ship was on charter to Singapore company. And so they were responsible for the cargo loading, discharging and handling. The gas container was a cargo, so it exploded. So the cause of explosion, the damage is the container. Therefore, as ship owners, we inform them that you are liable for all the damages, and we need at least, not a bank guarantee, but at least a letter of undertaking from your insurance company that in the event you are held liable, after investigations that your insurance company will settle our claim.
Hmm.
And they, in the first instance, decline on the basis that it's too early to determine who is liable.
Hmm.
Because whether it is the ship or it is the gas container loaded by them. And they decline. Then what happened? Following day, our lawyers in London seize the accounts of this company in New York. And they were operating about 60, 70 vessels. And all of their operations came to a standstill.
Right.
And there's a provision to do that. And then immediately after seizure, they gave us the letter of undertaking. So that is the first step. So we, in our hand, has this letter of undertaking. Then adjusters and lawyers, they came on board. The vessel was taken to closest port of Abu Dhabi. Contains were discharged.
But now, the difference between that situation and this situation, in that case, we were the owners or the charterers of the vessel.
Yes.
But in this case, Sri Lanka is just a third-party casualty in this entire incident.
Yes.
So how do you believe that Sri Lanka should
oppose Now it is very clear that this ship owner is liable for the damages caused to environment. And there is a wreck also that is that has to be removed. So they have to remove it. Otherwise we have to remove and they have
to pay us.
Now environmental damage is not assessed. Now what I believe what we have to do it first inform them that they are liable for these damages and demand a bank guarantee or letter of undertaking from the insurance company to be kept with us until this claim is ready. When the claim is adjusted, it should be adjusted by an independent party, not by the claimant. It should be assessed by an independent party and certified adjuster, not by layman, and each and every word in the adjustment need proof. Because I remember when that incident happened, what I referred earlier, that a container full of pieces, metal pieces, collected from the ship here and there was sent to London for lab test.
Right.
The adjuster, what now? Adjuster say, now, for instance, if you say that this is due to a leakage, now someone can now say it is not due to a leakage. Can you prove now it is due to a leakage? It's only assumption. Now, the moment it happened, forensic type audits, like I think in our case, they did. They cut pieces and send, and there's a lab test to say that this is nitric acid.
Right, right.
Just because you prepare something and say nitric acid, someone else says, no, we
this
don't.
Is not nitric acid. Yeah, you need proof for everything.
Yeah, they might say we don't know, it might say something else.
And Mr. Gunawardhana, the company or the insurance company, the owners of this ship are only liable for the damages that this incident has caused. There are certain damages that can be claimed under compensation or as damages, and there are certain things that we cannot claim that will be, of course, an inevitable consequence of this incident that has happened off the coast of Sri Lanka. Stay tuned. We will continue this discussion after a short commercial break. Don't go anywhere. You're watching Newsline Live.
News First, Newsline.
Invest in the port city, an economic zone with many concessions and privileges. President invites investors. Construction of an elevated expressway and 6 flyovers begins. CID to launch operations from today to locate those who disseminate false information on social media. Court order issued to provide security to the stricken Express Pearl container ship.
Newsline. Welcome back. You're watching Newsline Live. We're continuing our discussion with Attorney at Law Gunawardhana. Sir, as we were speaking about the compensation for this incident surrounding the Express Pearl vessel, what sort of damages could we really claim for? Let's have a quick fire round. Of course, we know that we can claim for the environmental damage that this has caused. Does this environmental damage include the loss of fish stocks for our fishermen who are currently suffering without income?
The environmental losses are two kinds. One is direct losses and indirect losses. Like this, loss is the cleaning expenditure. That means now we have
clean up operation.
How much it will cost, and it is not a small amount, perhaps it is a big amount. And
then, and these are not incidents that you can just clean up by organizing by local groups or
cleaning up operation, and then thereafter damage caused to the these other sea the beaches and the fish and various other kind of damages, and those are I believe those are consequential losses. That mean immediate losses. That mean how then we have to. I'm not sure how adjuster will assess that. Now somebody has to assess that. Okay. Now if you feel that these are losses, you have to assess that and with proof. So I don't know how you prove how many fishes were killed, and for the next 1 or 2 years what will happen. I don't know how to assess that. You have to assess. If you assess it and clean up operations, the cost for the clean up operation and those consequential losses, you can claim from the ship. There is nothing to say. I mean, there is no bar. You can claim the ship. Now the question I think that you asked me is whether the ship has insured or the insurance cover the ship has is sufficient, or they cover these this type of damages.
Right, yes.
Yeah. As far as I know, insurance cover says clean up operation, that they cover cleaning up. They don't say that they cover various other damages. Therefore, there is a question whether we can add all those things into our claim. Of course we can do, but whether the ship owner can
get
their insurance company to pay us all those things. And there is a question. And that depends on how much
we claim. So couldn't it come out of the owner's pocket? If it's not insured,
yes.
that doesn't automatically mean we can't claim it.
Then come on the owner's pocket. With regard to the wreck removal also, there is a limitation like that, because wreck removal, there is a convention that is called Nairobi Convention on Wreck Removal. And in addition, there is another convention, Limitation of Liability Convention 1976. And this convention has pass a resolution where ship's liability is limited to a certain amount. Then ship cause damages to somebody else.
But is Sri Lanka really a signatory to these conventions that you mentioned?
Sri Lanka is not signatory to
both of those conventions.
Both of these conventions.
Limitation of liability and the Nairobi Convention.
Therefore, we can say even the ship has ratified the country, the ship's registered country where the ship is registered, ratified, we have not ratified. Therefore, we are not subjected to that kind of limitations. Therefore, you have to pay the entire claim.
And also, since this incident did occur in Sri Lankan seas, doesn't it naturally fall under Sri Lankan jurisdiction?
Yeah, in Sri Lankan jurisdiction also, there are no laws imposed directly for similar incidents. But if you go to the normal civil law, even you can claim whatever amount you want. There is no, but only thing, ship owner's insurance company might try to limit up to the liability. But if ship owner become liable, still insurance companies under obligation to settle the claim.
So as far as where the claim should be filed, is it going to be arbitrated by international arbitrators or is it in Sri Lankan courts?
Sri Lankan courts.
Right.
Yeah. Sri Lankan courts we can file, otherwise we can go to... Now in Sri Lanka we have this Admiralty Jurisdiction Act also. Under this act also, if you have a claim against another ship, and we have even arrest a sister ship, and not only when it comes to Sri Lanka, but whenever that ship comes to any other country where that country has ratified this same law as we have
On admiralty jurisdiction.
So right. We can go to that country and arrest the sister ship. So that way also we can take action against the ship owners. But basically these two are covered, but I have seen in journals that environmental pollution claims hitherto when claim from the insurance companies, they had paid. They had not, because those claims perhaps are not very big. I don't know the level, I mean the how large it is, but because now I don't know how our claim is going to be assessed. Damages are assessed. You can assess as you want, no? You can say it is 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 4 million, whatever way.
And then we've also got to come up with a justification on how we came up with that number.
Whatever you assess, my feeling is that should be assessed by an independent adjuster who is qualified to do that, with all supporting documents and evidences.
Given your years of expertise in this field, do you believe that Sri Lanka needs to seek international experts for this task? Or do we have the required expertise here in Sri Lanka?
In fact, I don't know. In Sri Lanka also, there may be experts. And I think Sri Lanka, their claim will be handled by Attorney General's Department. In Attorney General's Department, there are senior lawyers. There are lawyers who are qualified in even maritime law. And they know what is happening around the world. And so I believe that they will not miss the path. They will take the appropriate action. I don't know so far what have been done, but I said my experience is we immediately, our underwriters appointed a firm in London, solicitors, and they are experts, and average adjuster who prepared the claim, and with all evidences. And when that is done that way, ship owners, insurance company never challenge that.
When it's done the proper way.
They never challenge that, because they will settle the claim, of course, subject to liability limits, because if the law says ship owner is liable only this much, since the liability is insured, the insurance company pay only that much. If ship owner is liable much more, they will pay much more. That is the theory. So we can sometime use that method, and if you are not satisfied with the amount that the company, insurance company is prepared to pay, we can take some other action under the Admiralty Jurisdiction Act and process a claim against the ship owners. I think we need expert advice on this. I am telling that I have no experience of going that much. But as far as I know, insurance companies settle claims without much problems if everything is prepared in the proper way.
Well, we did have a similar incident of a lesser magnitude, of course, as far as the MT New Diamond ship off the eastern coast of Sri Lanka just a few months back.
Yes.
When it came to handling of this claim, I know it's an entirely different jurisdiction because it was in international waters. It was not in Sri Lankan waters. But besides that, as far as the process that Sri Lanka followed, because that could be a precursor to that is a precursor to what happened and could possibly help us if we have made any mistakes. Did we make any mistakes when that claim was handled, as far as your knowledge goes?
I don't know. I know what the normal procedure is. At sea, there is nothing called assistance. Any assistance rendered at sea is a salvage operation. So when there is salvage operation, if that property is saved, that ship is saved, the person who saved that is entitled for a reward that we call salvage, salvage reward. And now what will happen if a ship is in distress? Ship has to declare that it is in distress by way of radio communication or by sending SOS, whatever way. Then the people who have the capacity to go and help in the sense save, will go there, and some people will try to negotiate an amount with the captain, and some people will go and if captain has no time to do that, voluntarily extinguish the fire,
right,
if it is a fire or something. Then if that, then they become entitled for reward. But what happened nowadays is on those ships there is a standard form of agreement, which is called Lloyd's Open Form, and which is no cure, no pay, and that is because captain has no time.
That is the story surrounding the MT New Diamond, but this is an entirely different matter, right, because it has happened in Sri Lankan waters.
This has already happened.
And as you said, I believe the major takeaway would be that if Sri Lanka processes this claim properly, the chance of the insurer accepting the terms or the claim of Sri Lanka is much, much higher than if there are some loopholes to which the insurer or the owner could bring up challenges in a court of law. Thank you very much, Attorney at Law Gunawardhan, for clarifying those matters regarding this claim that Sri Lanka is currently processing to file against the Express Pearl ship owners and the insurers. Of course, as we have done always, News First will continuously follow closely the developments surrounding the Express Pearl vessel and how successful we are in claiming compensation for this massive environmental damage. And also, we will focus on how the environment has been affected by this incident and what the authorities are doing to make things right. Thank you very much for tuning in to Newsline Live. Until we meet again, take care and God bless.